Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Good morning. Come on in. It's about that time where we ask God through this very famous liturgical prayer, Ose Shalom Bimromav, Hu Ya'ase Shalom Aleinu V'al Kol Yisrael. May he who makes peace in his heights make peace for us and for all Israel. And this is the traditional version of it. So let's start it nice and calmly. Here we go. Oh, say shalom b'mromav. Hu yaseh shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. Shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael v'iru v'imru amen. Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu. Yoko Yisrael, yase shalom, shalom aleinu, Yoko Yisrael, yase shalom, shalom aleinu, Yoko Yisrael. Say shalom b'mromav. Oh, yase shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. V'iru v'imru amen. Yase shalom, shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. Yase shalom. Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. 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 The God of Israel, he is mighty. The God of Israel knows no defeat. He leads his people into battle. Before him his enemies must flee. Cry out with a shout of victory. Lift your voice all the earth. Sing and dance at the triumph of our King. You won the war, spoil the enemy. Cry out with a shout of victory. Lift your voice all the earth. Sing and dance at the triumph of our King. You won the war, spoil the enemy. God of Israel is our champion. Israel has got the victory. Our praises rises incense before him. He fights for us and routs the enemy. Cry out with a shout of victory. Lift your voice all the earth. Sing and dance at the triumph of our King. He won the war and spoiled the enemy. Cry out with a shout of victory. Bend your bones all the earth. Sing and dance at the triumph of our King. He won the war and spoiled the enemy. He won the war and spoiled the enemy. He won the war and spoiled. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. In Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm. They rush on the city, they run on the wall. Great is the army that carries out his word. They rush on the city, they run on the wall. Great is the army that carries out his word. The Lord utters his voice before his army. The Lord utters his voice before his army. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm. Sound the alarm. Sound the alarm. Havenu Shalom Malechem. Havenu Shalom Malechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom, Shalom, Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom, Shalom, Shalom Alechem. Since my hope and my prayer, that there be peace everywhere. That there'll be joy for all to share. So let us praise the Lord, live a happy life. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom Alechem. Havenu Shalom, 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 Shalom Alechem. Don't say we never gave you any Messianic Chuck music, because there it is. Now, we had this big eclipse this last week. It wasn't so big in Georgia, like it was just a little thing in Georgia. But this song came to my mind. Should have played it in advance of the eclipse, but it's such a good tune. Never heard it, but that's okay. Right? Is that okay? Okay. Lance has never heard it. He certainly never played it. So this is always fun.
From the birds they sing in the tallest trees. To the human life of you and me. From the desert sand to the place we stand. He is God of all, he is everything. Oh, give my light to the only one who makes the moon reflect the sun. Every starry night, that was his design. My life to the only Son who was and is yet to come. Let the praises ring, see his everything.
You ever heard this song?
From the autumn leaves that will ride the breeze. To the faith it takes to pray and sing. From the painted sky to my plain-filled eye. He is God of all, he is everything, yeah. Giving my life to the only one who makes the moon reflect the sun. Every star starry night. That was his design. Giving my life to the only son who was and is yet to come. Let the praises ring. He is everything. He is everything. Starry night, that was his design. Giving my life to the only son who was and is yet to come. Let the praises ring, 'cause he is everything. Giving my life to the only one who makes the moon reflect the sun. Every starry night, that was his design. Giving my life to the only son who was and is yet to come. Let the angels sing, he is heavenly. So let the praises ring, he is everything.
To you, all to you.
all the world holds dear. I count it all at loss for the sake of knowing you. The glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your pain. And to the heaven. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. I will lift my eyes. reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Together, my friends. God who is faithful through all the generations. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Elohe Avoteinu Elohe Abraham Elohe Yitzchak Elohe Yaakov Ha'el Hagadol Hagibur V'chanora El Elyon Gomel Chasadim Tovim V'konei Hakol V'zocher Chasdei Avoy U'mevi Goel Livnei V'neihem L'man Shemo Be'achava Melech Ozer Moshiach U'magen Baruch Ata Adonai Magen Avraham. The God who is faithful to resurrect the dead. Atagi boi le'olam adonai, mechayim etim atav v'rav lehoshia, mashiv haruach u'morid ha'gashem, mechalkel chayim bechesed, mechayim etim berachamim rabim, somech noflim v'rofech holim, u'matir asurim, Umkayem emunato lishene afar Miha mocha ba'al givurot Umidomelach Melech memit umchayeh Umatzmiach Yeshua V'nemanata halech achayot meitim Baruch ata Adonai Mechayeh ha-meitim. To the Holy One of Israel, seated above the heavens. Kadosh, 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 Adonai Tzevaot, Baruch Ata Adonai, Ha'el HaKadosh. Gives us this day of rest and refreshing. Baruch Ata Adonai Mekadesh HaShabbat. To the God restoring His presence to Zion. Baruch Ata Adonai HaMachazir Shechinato LeTzion. To the God who is worthy of all thanksgiving and whose name is good. Baruch Ata Adonai HaTov Shimcha Ulchanei Lehodot. To the God who grants us peace. Baruch Ata Adonai HaMvarech Et Amo Yisrael BaShalom. Amen. As disciples of Yeshua, this is our prayer for the kingdom. Avinu Shabbat Shemayim Yikadesh Mecha Tavo Machutecha Ve'ase Ritzonecha Kasher Bashamayim Gam Ba'aretz Et Nachmenu Lemachar Ten Lanu King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. You may be seated. We wish you a Shabbat Shalom wherever, all over the world. We're happy that you're here with us. Happy that you're choosing to honor this, the holy day, the first among the things called holy. Our work at Shalom Macon is supported by offerings. You can give them at that link right there. Become a regular giver. You can also do that at the back of the sanctuary in the box. Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. 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 Shabbat, Shabbat, Shabbat Shalom. Am Yisrael, Am Yisrael, Am Yisrael Chai. 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 O Rabbeinu Chai, O Rabbeinu Chai. O Rabbeinu, O Rabbeinu, O Rabbeinu Chai. O Rabbeinu Chai, O Rabbeinu Chai. O Rabbeinu, O Rabbeinu, O Rabbeinu Chai. Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom, good morning. Have y'all stood up enough today? I don't think so. Everybody stand up for me, please. Come on, come on. It's not that hard. You do it every day. All right. And then turn around and look at the camera and say, hello. Welcome, everyone. We are so grateful that y'all are with us. We just, and to especially to the hunters who have made it home safely from their visit here and have gotten back to life. So we thank y'all so much for doing that. And we would also like to welcome David Nowak from Levy County, Florida, Taylor and Jess Schindler from Maine, Bob Stillwell from Manchester, New Hampshire, James Berry from Chapel Hill, Tennessee, Jenna and Christopher Sabin. Jenna is joining us from Virginia Beach, but Christopher is joining us from the USS New York. So welcome. Thank y'all so much, and that's pretty cool. We have people from Ohio, England, Canada, Japan, California, Washington, India, Indiana, Texas, Montana, Nebraska, Missouri, Mississippi, and New York joining us today. We are so grateful for y'all. Thank y'all so much. So a couple of bad newses. No Torah Club, no Kids Hebrew today. So y'all are out, but you have Lunch and Learn at 1 o'clock today for is Pesach number 2 teaching. So y'all come, be prepared for that, and come on in for that. But then, pardon me, at 7 p.m. tonight, we have a mail requirement that you be here at 7 p.m., whether online or in person, so you can learn your manly role of Pesach for Torah on Tap tonight. Darren's going to lead us in that. So let's make sure that you are here, guys. It's a really important time, so y'all come and learn and fellowship and get to know each other better. And then college and career will be next Saturday at 4 p.m. online, so make sure that you are ready for that. And just as a reminder, there are signs all up in the kitchen stating that the kitchen has been cleaned for Passover. So if you bring some hummets in, clean your hummets up. Make sure you do not make a mess. Karen is not your mother. She's the mother of one child and not going to clean up after you. So if you, Saturday, 2 weeks, please don't bring any hummets in the building. So, because that will be during Passover time. So, but most importantly of all, if you would like to maintain your membership here at Shalom Macon, you must attend the kickball game tomorrow at 6 o'clock at the South Bibb County Recreation Department, for where we are going for the championship. We are the number one seed team. Way to go, guys. Very proud of you. But you better not lose 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock, because if you do, you're excommunicated from the community. No, I'm just kidding, but y'all better bring that trophy home. Y'all come out and support these guys. It's a whole lot of fun. And so, let's see. I have one little other thing. Oh, usually when I come out from under here, I bring my hat. But today's a very special day. And I don't normally do this because she's probably going to kill me anyway. But Melanie, will you come on up here? Today, this sweet bride and I are celebrating 24 years of I don't know how she's put up with me that long. We do have a cake that I asked that y'all help celebrate us with after services today. But it's not Passover yet. And so, yes, I brought hummets into the building. But happy anniversary, my love.
every once in a while, God just stirs something in me, and Rabbi, see, that's what happens when you have a connection. You guys can't do this. You can't just walk up here and talk. You get reprimanded. Let's see. Touch, smell, taste, sight, and hearing. Right? How many of you couldn't take your eyes off of this corner? Michael, is gifting us with overseeing, and Sabrina signing. Now, I'm just late to the party because I've always viewed that as just a necessary thing for people that can't hear. But I developed a new sense. I'd stirred an emotion to me today in me watching them pray our messianic music and song and blessings and prayer with their bodies and their hands and their heart. And I didn't want to let that come and go without expressing it for you and at home. This is an amazing, special new gift that we have at Shalom Macon. Thank you so much.
There's quite a story behind all of that. Sabrina happens to have a master's degree in deaf education. Several years ago at a conference, a Malchut conference, Sabrina felt a prompting of God that one day she would be able to help in leading the deaf community in Messianic Jewish teaching and understanding. We met Michael at the Malchut conference back in March, and he is, as you can see, a passionate, spirited Messianic Jewish believer. Turns out he's from Georgia. And so the way that God puts a puzzle together is like no one else. It's really, really miraculous. So we're enjoying having Michael. This has been here. This is his second week, and we're figuring all this out. But I mean, another thing that God has given Shalom Macon to be a light into the deaf community so that they too can appreciate and understand the Jewish roots of the Christian faith and of Yeshua as a Jewish Messiah and Messiah for the nations, that there's just not an easy way. There's not a lot of education. So thank you, God, right? Baruch Hashem. Kids, let's go to Shabbat school. As they're making their way up, I do need to stress, Dave did a good job of it. We are playing at 6 o'clock to get into the championship at 7 o'clock. So we have to play two games. We won two games in a row last week. This is a hodgepodge group of people who've never really done anything athletic together, and God has anointed us. So come out to South Bibb Recreational Complex at 6 tomorrow and cheer us on for that win. This was Cody Leckberg's idea to do a kickball team, and I'm thankful to Cody for doing that. Yisimcha Elohim ke Ephraim v'hi Menashe. May the Lord make you like Ephraim and Menashe. Yisimech Elohim ke Sarah Rivka Rachel Valea. May the Lord make you like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. Father, this is a blessing. Not my nose breath in this microphone. That's not a blessing. This is just this. All of it, all of it. It's a blessing, but this is the calling. This is the important thing. This is the generation. So, Father, help us to lead and guide. Give them a place to be strengthened as disciples and to build meaningful, lasting friendships between one another so that they will always feel community and friends. Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Yo'er Adonai pono ve'lecha v'yihunecha. Yisar Adonai pono ve'lecha ve'yasem lecha shalom. All right, you can go to Shabbat school. We've got a little Ephraim here in Menashe. I wonder if anyone had to face any imposters this week. I know that surprisingly, I had a moment that I just was caught completely unaware of facing an imposter in my own life when I, this week, having just given that teaching last week and then realizing, oh my gosh, I'm so caught up and concerned about what somebody thinks about me. I faced it. I hope maybe you did. I hope maybe you moved a little bit closer to your this, that you drew near, that God called you near from last week. And I think we had a meaningful time last week. And then suddenly we find ourselves moving from the dedication of the altar, the priests, this come near message, all of this amazing stuff, to what certainly is one of the weirdest parts of the Torah, and even for Leviticus. That is this week's Torah portion, which is called Tazria, and it's about something in particular called Tzarat. Say it with me. Roll your R real good. Tzarat. Tzarat. Let me just give you, in case you didn't get a chance to read the Torah portion, I want to give you a little bit of context for what we're going to talk about today. This is Leviticus 13. Hashem spoke to Moses and Aaron saying, I will skim for context. When a person has on the skin of the body a swelling, a rash, or a discoloration, and it develops into a scaly affection on the skin of the body, it shall be reported to Aaron the priest or to one of his sons the priest. The priest shall examine the affection on the skin of the body. If hair is in the affected patch, has turned white, the affection appears to be deeper than the skin of the body. It is a leprous affection. When the priest sees it, he shall pronounce the person impure. But if it is a white discoloration on the skin of the body, which does not appear to be deeper than the skin, and the hair in it has not turned white, the priest shall isolate the affected person for 7 days. But if the rash should spread on the skin after the person has been seen by the priest and pronounced pure, the person shall again report to the priest. If the priest sees that the rash is spread on the skin, the priest shall pronounce that person impure. It is leprosy. Who's excited? David Higginbotham is excited, and that comes as no surprise. But the thing is, to make things even more challenging, if you've been around Torah study for any time, Messianic Jewish teaching, I didn't get a chance to watch Darren's 5-minute Torah this week. He may have talked about it. It's actually not leprosy. Even though most of your translations end that section by saying it is leprosy, it's not leprosy as we know the term. Hansen's disease. You familiar with this? How about Mycobacterium leprae? That's what causes Hansen's disease, which is actually leprosy. This slow-growing bacterium primarily is going to affect skin, nerves, mucous membranes. It leads to symptoms like skin lesions and all kinds of weird numbness, muscle weakness, paralysis of the hands and feet. Did you know that the World Health Organization will give you free of charge medicine to treat your leprosy? It might take 6 to 12 months, but it is curable. Good news, right? But that's not what we're talking about. This isn't actually leprosy, tzarat. That's in Hebrew, but then we have to ask, and this is just by way of information, then why does the Bible call it leprosy, and how did that get in there if that's not what it is? Well, this is an amazing little, what's the thing where you have a study of words that the word escapes me right now? Yeah, listen. Septuagint, okay? The Septuagint was the first significant translation that dealt with the term related to tzarat. It was the Septuagint, a translation of tzarat into Greek. Do you know what word they chose? Lepros. Lepros in Greek, which actually does not mean leprosy, but generally speaks to a large catalog of skin conditions. Then in the 4th century, along came Saint Jerome, who translated the Bible into what language? Latin, the Latin Vulgate. And so what did Saint Jerome do? He took tzarat, Septuagint, lepros, into Latin, lepra, okay? Which still doesn't actually mean specifically leprosy. It also means a general catalog of skin disorders. And then who do you think showed up? 1611, King Jimmy. King Jimmy and the boys came along and they translated tzarat to lepros to lepra, to, in English, leprosy, which by 1611, leprosy pretty much meant leprosy. Things were falling off of you, right? That's how we got this word, leprosy, and along is born biblical leprosy. That's what it's generally called. But how many people know enough about the Torah that when they see the word leprosy in their translations, they think, oh, that's not leprosy? Every Jesus movie I've ever seen where he's healing the lepers, they're wrapped in white bandages, like everyone's terrified of them. They're oozing and their fingers are falling off. That's not what's happening. Okay, we got that clear? Tzarat is not a medical condition. It sounds gross, that's for sure. White patches growing, white hairs, and I mean, you have certain components, hints that would make one think of a leper colony. You have isolation, you have pure or impure, we even have a quarantine that the Torah talks about. But listen to this. This is from Leviticus 13, verses 12 and 13. If the eruption spreads out over the skin so that it covers all the skin of the affected person from head to foot, wherever the priest can see, if the priest sees that the eruption has covered the whole body, he shall pronounce as pure the affected person. That seems opposite, right? If you have a medical condition in which you're trying to contain contagion and it's all over the body, you wouldn't release the person into society and call them pure. Or what about this? When an eruptive affection occurs in a cloth of wool or linen fabric, in the warp or in the woof of the linen or the wool or the skin, that actually means leather, not like this skin, some kind of garment or bag or something. If that shows up, can clothes get sick? Can clothes develop medical conditions? Or how about this? This is from next week's Parsha. It's called Metzora. Metzora is the name for one who has contracted tzarat on the skin. Metzora. That's next week's Torah portion. Who's excited? This is 14. Hashem spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, when you enter the land of Canaan that I give you as a possession, and I inflict an eruptive plague upon a house in the land that you possess, the owner of the house shall come and tell the priest, something like a plague has appeared on my house. Can houses get sick, developing medical conditions like Hansen's disease? Oh, sweetie, the doorknob fell off. We need to get some antibiotic. It then goes on to say, the priest shall order the house cleared before the priest enters to examine the plague, so that nothing in the house may become impure. Meaning, you take everything out of the house, but if it were already in a house that has tzaraat, you're taking it out. That's opposite. So have I made this point? Tzaraat is not a medical condition. Let me read you something, actually, which will give a nice summary. As I'm doing it, who treats tzaraat? Do you know? Well, nobody treats it. Where do they go? They go to the wilderness wellness clinic. Mount Sinai Family Care. No, the priest, they go to the priest. The priest identifies the condition. There's no doctor or treating going on. Dr. Eisner, I'm having a hard time seeing up close these days. Is there anything that can be done? That's not part of the teaching. All this to say, this is a spiritual condition, not a medical one. As the sages teach, with these glasses, do I look more sagely? As the sages teach, tzaraat is not a bodily disease, but the physical manifestation of a spiritual malaise, a punishment designed to show the malefactor that he must mend his ways. The primary cause of tzaraat is the sin of slander. The sages say this. They also teach that the affliction is punishment for the sins of bloodshed, false oaths, sexual immorality, pride, robbery, selfishness. The pattern that emerges is that a divine retribution for the offender's failure to feel the needs and share the hurt of others. God rebukes this antisocial behavior by isolating him from society so that he can experience the pain he has imposed on others and heal himself through antibiotics, repentance, through repentance, which is interesting. Notice, there's no sacrifice, okay? You do bring a sacrifice, we'll talk about that next week, but the first part of the process is not bringing a bull and saying, God, take away this bad condition. What is it? Repentance. Okay, that's just a little side note for the sacrificial system. With that pool of things to talk about, just Lashon Hara, I could go 1,000 directions talking about Lashon Hara, but I just recently gave you a teaching about silence and Lashon Hara, so let's go a different way. What do you think? I want to point out something about the things that are affected by tzaraat. We just talked about them. People close houses, right? And that's the way they're presented in the Torah. In chapters 13, we have this presentation. But listen, we're going to start with a bit of insight, deep wisdom from another Jewish sage of a different ilk. Here is the word of wisdom. Compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. He who understands it earns it. He who does not pays it. You know who said it? Albert Einstein. Well, supposedly, it doesn't matter. It's a quote and it's attributed to Albert Einstein. But listen, it emphasizes the powerful effect of what I want to talk to you about today, compounding. Yes, financial education, we learn about compound interest. You need to save, you need to invest, it works for you. But guess what? This also happens in our spiritual lives, or life in general, but, you know, I'm a spiritual guy, so I'm going to apply it to the Bible. Now, here's what you might be thinking. How in the world is he going to tie leprosy, Albert Einstein, and things growing on people's walls in their houses. I'm going to do it. Stick with me. Trust me. You ready? The Torah, as I said, presents this particular order. Person is described in our portion, what happens when they get it, the clothes, and then actually the house. But what you note, in practice, actually, it went the other way, okay? Even though the Torah presents it this way, what happened was Tzorat first, now there are exceptions. Miriam, Moses actually had a white hand at one point. There are exceptions, but generally, Tzorat appears in the home first, then to the clothes, and then to the person, okay? Now, what I want you to see about that is there is a progression. If the person does not get the message, if they don't recognize that they're spiritually debased for whatever reason, they refuse to recognize this, they refuse to repent, then Tzorat ultimately makes its way to their body. But you understand that God mercifully starts the process disconnected from you in your own home. Okay? That's the way it shows up. But I want you to notice something interesting, and it's in next week's portion. But it says this. When you enter the, this is about Tzorat in the house. Okay? Just stay with me for a minute here. When you enter the land of Canaan that I give you as a possession, and I inflict an eruptive plague on the house and the land you possess, the owner of the house shall come to and tell the priest, saying, something like a plague has appeared on my house. Remember, this is the first appearing of the Tzorat. What is the person supposed to do? Acknowledge it. Go, speak to the priest, say something's wrong, and I've identified it. When the owner comes and, quote, tells the priest, when he admits, when he brings the issue forward to solve it, the priest gives him advice and says, this is what you need to do. This is what's going on. You're spiritually corrupted. You need to make some changes. And at that point, the owner should be influenced to repent. In other words, this leprosy, which has been completely misunderstood as your toes and fingers falling off, is actually a repair. It's a call to repentance from God to understand something is way off inside of me. And it's inside of you. His mercy starts on your house, not your body. And that's incredible. Before it progresses, before it gets bad, but what if he or she doesn't address it? What if they ignore it? What if it just, stupid red or green growth on the wall, so what? What happens? Compounding. It moves to your garments. Remember, spiritual compounding, according to Einstein, he who doesn't understand it pays it. If you're unwilling to acknowledge, if you're unwilling to understand, compounding. It's coming to your clothing. And if you persist in your bad behavior, compounding. It's coming to your skin. It moves to your skin and quarantine, ultimately leading to shame, ultimately having your dirty laundry aired before the entire community. Because when someone has Tzorat and they're publicly out there, they are now humiliated because everyone knows something is wrong with this person. They're selfish. They're lashon haraing. But it was preventable. It was preventable. First and foremost, the most basic prevention would have been to not do the thing in the first place, right? But you did the thing. But you could at any time stop the negative compounding. It takes honesty. It takes humility. It takes discipline, sacrifice to stop the progression. And if not, compounding will take over. And this truth has been understood since the Mishnah. Pirkei Avot. It's in the Mishnah. In Tractate Avot, chapter 4, Ben Azai says this, run to perform a minor mitzvah and flee from a transgression. For one mitzvah leads to another mitzvah, and one transgression leads to another transgression, for the reward of a mitzvah is a mitzvah, and the reward of a transgression is a transgression. Do you get it? It's very clear. It's compounding, spiritual compounding. Each action, good or bad, sets off a chain reaction leading to more of the same. And just as compound interest accumulates wealth for you, so do our actions accumulate spiritual and moral consequences for the good or for the bad. So let me introduce the spirit, the concept of spiritual compounding by way of one of my favorite things in the world, a book called Atomic Habits. Who's read it? Came out 10 years ago, roughly. I think I've read it twice. There's almost no day that goes by that I don't think about something from Atomic Habits. James Clear. The book. It is the book of the story of compounding effect in our lives. What he says, basically, if you haven't read it, the premise is little atomic changes, 1% changes daily can result in incredible reward in your life over the long term. Atomic, micro, the size of atom, 1% improvements. He shows in the book how this leads to more productive, satisfied, balanced life. I want to show you a graph from the book, and I want to relate it to Tzaraat, Pirkei Avot, and our spiritual health. You ready? Look at it. It's kind of small, but the positive line, obviously you might guess which one that one is. The positive line, green, 1% better every day, 365 days. Leads to a 38 times positive effect in your life. You know what that's called? Compounding. For one mitzvah leads to another mitzvah. The reward of a mitzvah is another mitzvah. But it's most important that you would notice the negative effects of compounding. You zero yourself out. 1% worse over 365 days, you are out. You're at zero. You are done. Negative compounding. Now, it's hard to quantify what is 1%. I mean, but listen, I want to ask you this question. How many times have you seen something like this happen in your life? Let me point it very clearly to you. You slip, you slide. They say in the church, backslidden, right? He's backslidden, okay? You slip, you slide, you descend, and ultimately you bottom out. You lose your discipline. Your effort slacks, and you can apply it to whatever area you want. If you want to do it for real life, put it in your diet. Put it in your exercise. Put it in your commitment to your work, to a project, your commitment to your family, spending time with your wife, and certainly in your relationship with God. Living a life of spiritual discipline, serving, giving, loving, whatever it is, the less you invest in it, the easier it is to let it go. To justify it. Worse yet, to ignore it. To just ignore Your compound negative impacts. One transgression leads to another transgression. The reward of a transgression is not a reward. It's another transgression. And it's down the slope. So these negative effects of spiritual compounding, you know what they leave you with? Metaphorical tzarat. You have this isolated, living far below your potential. You're convicted, you're guilty, you're embarrassed, and you're a far, far, far away from the this that we talked about last week. Because you're far away from your potential. You've gone the wrong way. And that is exactly what happened to our metzora, our person afflicted with tzarat, from house to garment to skin. It gets on you, it gets in you. The negative. And it happens to us if we let it. But here's the great news. When you recognize it, when you see it on your metaphorical walls, what you do next makes all the difference in the world. There's a rule in Atomic Habits that I think about so often after a mistake or failure, which, by the way, are nearly inevitable. I don't know anyone who doesn't make mistakes or failures. But there's a rule. I thought about it this week reading about biblical leprosy. It's quite a simple but powerful statement. Three words. You ready? Never miss twice. Never miss twice. He's talking about slipping up in a habit, skipping a workout, indulging in junk food when you got some diet, but the concept applies spiritually. That's what I'm applying. The most important thing you can do is to make sure that you don't persist in the same mistake. When you're aware enough to see the tzarat, stop and change. Don't repeat the cycle. Don't compound the negative spiritual interest. Never miss twice. Deal with it. Confront it. Don't let it compound. Turn transgression around. It is grounded. The whole rule is grounded in the fact that perfection isn't the goal. Consistency is the thing. Consistency, not perfection. It leads to spiritual growth, positive compounding. By making sure that one mistake doesn't turn into a streak, you maintain your upward trajectory. It's a practical approach to be aware. Okay? I read this fantastic quote in a Musar book I was reading recently. Rabbi Nelson Finkel, 19th century Musar teacher. Don't be better. Be higher. I love that. It's going on my wall somewhere. Don't be better. Be higher. You say, what's the difference? Well, there is a difference. The goal of self-improvement, which is a big part of what the Torah is actually about, is not just to improve your life or become a better person. And you say, well, of course it is. I always want to be a better person. No, the point is to become spiritually elevated. That's a part of being better, but there's no end point to spiritual elevation. Be higher, not better. And notice this compounding effect as well when we're looking at this. The higher you climb, the higher you elevate on this spiritual elevation curve, the less of an effect that a fall is going to have. Do you understand? If you are at 2 and you have a fall, where are you? 0. You're starting over. If you've climbed this, if you've ascended the levels and you're at, for, I don't know, 100, and you fall, where do you fall? Just a little bit. Just a little bit. You don't have to collapse all the way down to 0 when you've invested and spiritually compounded the goodness in your life. And furthermore, when you're up here, it looks way, way far down there. Who wants to go back to that? No one. There's a personal motivation in this spiritual compounding. Be holy, for I am holy, is a potential ever-ascending spiritual journey. Be aware of negative compounding. Embrace the positive effect. Albert, thank you, Albert. He or she who understands this earns it. You see? Now, this is the last. Passover message. Passover's next week. The Passover message is next week. So this is your pre-Passover message. The never miss twice rule, spiritual discipline, okay? The Torah provides this path for these mitzvah for purification and restoration after they're misstep. You see God's mercy and patience. We prevent this negative compounding in our lives and our families by responding to the initial signs of moral failure. Now, Passover is coming. It's the season of redemption. But you also remember that it is the season of ascent. It's the season of going higher. According to Jewish tradition, while in Egypt, the Israelites, you remember this, descended. They fell basically to zero. Actually, it was the 49th level of impurity, which is virtually impossible to recover from. That's where their spiritual debasement in Egypt had taken them. 49th level. However, their exodus marked the beginning of a spiritual journey that was taking them toward the Torah. That journey, you'll know, is referenced, is mirrored in what we do from Passover to Shavuot, which is what? Sfirat HaOmer. What do we do with the Omer? We count it. How do we count it? Up. We don't count down. We count up, because we're ascending to something special. Each day represents this, the daily Omer count. This is positive spiritual compounding. Beautiful parallel. Ben Azai, run to perform a minor mitzvah, flee from transgression, for one mitzvah leads to another mitzvah, and the transgression leads to another transgression, for the reward of a mitzvah is a, and the reward of a transgression is a failure. Who wants to be a failure? Who wants to stack failure upon failure? Of course you don't. We haven't even had Passover yet, and this guy's up here counting the Omer. No, I'm just getting you ready for all of it. See, Pesach in the Messianic community is a very special time. You have not just the Exodus from Egypt, but we have our redemption from our mistakes. It's a time to see the potential allegorical tzarat all over your walls or your skin, God forbid. And to thank God for the gift of Yeshua, of forgiveness, of purification, of second chances. We're recommitting to the 38 times spiritual compounding graph and never missing twice. Better, not better, higher. Shabbat Shalom. Let's stand. I lost my tallit. Alina le shabeach la don hakol la teit gedul aliot ser bereshit shelo asanu kigoye haratzod velo samanu k'mishpachot adama. Shelo sam chelkenu kahem, vigor aleinu kichol hamonam, v'anachnu korim u'mishtachavim u'modim, lifnei melech malhei hamlachim, hakadosh baruch hu, shehu noteh shemayim v'yoseh ra'aretz, u'moshav yikaro b'shemayim imal, u'shchinatu zo b'gofei merumim. Hu Eloheinu Einod, emet malkeinu efes zulato, Kakatu bitorato veada tachayom veada tachayom lehashivota elevavecha ki Adonai hu haElohim bashamayim mimal vial haaretz mi hitakatenon enon. V'ne'emar v'chaya Adonai l'melech al kol ha'aretz v'yom ha'hu v'yom ha'hu yiye Adonai echad u'shemo 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 echad u'shemo echad. On that day, the Lord will be one, and his name will be one. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Hashem Yeshua. Yorechech Adonai v'yishmarecha. Yo'er Adonai ponav elecha vihuneka. Yisa Adonai ponav elecha ve'yasem lecha shalom. Shabbat shalom, my friends. Not better, but higher.